It's Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock, it's time for Magic TV. I'm Mashi Scanlan, the guy on the left. With me, Ben Seck at TBS-TheBenSeck. There's so many things I got tongue-tied, I'm like, should I say Ben? And you know what's weird? I am so used to calling you TBS that everyone here refers to you as Ben, and it takes me, like, what? Who? What? Because I think every time I talk to you, I'm like, TBS,
well,
TBS.
At tournaments and in a Magic context, generally, TBS is what people call me because there's so many Bens.
Yeah.
Not only that, there's a lot of Ben S's in Magic.
It's true. It's not just Bens, Ben S's, yeah.
So TBS is a way of, like, distinguishing myself from that. But either way, it's fine.
It's just weird. You know, you get that way with nicknames where it's like, it's like, Ben, who's that? Oh, wait. That's right, Ben Seck. So, all right. Well, we have TBS, the Ben Seck. Behind the camera, we have our Magic TV intern, Armando Benavides, Big Worm. And then, of course, the star of Magic TV, Darksteel Humphrey. So, welcome. We got a great show. We missed last week, so it's like all this stuff that we didn't cover. We're going to talk about Iconic Masters, even though it's a little bit older. We haven't had a chance to talk about it here on Magic TV. Ixalan Limited Impressions, because obviously we got a lot of Ixalan Sealed coming up at pre-releases. A few Ixalan previews, cards we haven't touched on yet. We have GP Providence, our team event, and you know what? It didn't make the sidebar list, but because we have you here, TBS, I do just want to spend a second or two, or 10 or 50, discussing Magic Arena.
You want to start off there?
We can start there. We can start there. Before we start there, though,
okay.
I want to remind you that Magic TV and all of our top eights brought to you by ChannelFireball.com, where all of the Ixalan cards we talk about today and any Ixalan sealed product you want to acquire is available right now for pre-order on ChannelFireball.com. So check that out. Every booster pack, every booster box, and what do they call fat packs now? They're not called fat packs anymore.
I don't know. I like fat packs as a name.
Bundles.
I always get in trouble because, I still call them fat packs, just like I still call standard type 2. And then everyone always wants to correct me. And I'm that old man who wants you to get off his lawn and remembers the day back when fat packs came with books and novelizations and all that stuff. But now they're bundles, and they're great, and they're available right now on channelfireball.com. Okay, so... Not on the rundown here, but let's, because TBS works in gaming. I don't know. What's your official title?
I'm a creative director at Lucasfilm Games.
Yes.
So I work at Star Wars games, generally things you see on mobile, but mm-hmm. I work across a lot of different things.
So we have we've got a lot of insight into design, particularly of digital games.
Yeah.
So what are your impressions of Arena?
So I'm pretty excited. But I'm also tentatively excited. So for the longest time, obviously, people were kind of like a little bit down on Magic Online. Magic Online has a lot of kind of issues with stability, UI. To be honest, the actual gameplay, like, screen is not too bad. But then, like, getting into a match or finding a tournament, it's a really, really ugly. And it looks a little dated, unfortunately. And I mean, I play a lot of Magic Online. I wish it was better. I wish it was a little bit more encompassing. But it's actually a pretty tough challenge because if you think there's like 15,000 Magic cards, I think like 14,000 of them are actually on Magic Online.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about the different combinations and permutations that can work with something that complex, it's pretty tough. But I think a lot of the things that they could have fixed with Magic Online, they didn't get to because they were a little bit underfunded. I think they didn't know where they wanted to go with it.
So one of the things, and there was a great video, they rolled it out during Hascon, kind of showing gameplay with the Arena, the new Magic Arena product. And I think, did you sign up for the beta?
I did.
Are you in the beta yet?
I'm not in the beta yet.
Yes. Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso and I both got in there, signed up, and then immediately after they made the announcement, the servers crashed.
Oh.
So we're like, we made it just under the... No, I have not heard back yet, but it's interesting. And it raises the question, you didn't touch on this, but, you know, Magic Online, when you play it or when someone else watches you play it, it becomes very readily apparent that this is just a digitized form of the card game.
Right.
You are clearly just playing a card game. There's no bells and whistles. There's nothing fancy. They're not taking, because there's all this extra. There's this extra design space,
right,
in terms of interaction and viewership in the digital realm that we don't get with cards.
Right. But the important thing to remember is Magic Online is like a 15-year-old product.
Mm-hmm.
I actually started playing it in 2000, which is actually longer than 15, because I was actually playing the beta for the original Magic Online.
But there's been what, two or two major up
four
major updates. Or yeah, did they change everything?
No, yeah, this is V4.
V4, right? Yeah.
And so, I think when you think about that, okay, it like it's showing its age, but at the time there was actually not a lot of context for other games like it.
No, definitely not. And it was, I mean, let's be honest here. We can complain about and every time Magic Online comes up, I feel like I have to say this again, old man Mashi. You can complain about Magic Online all you want. You can complain about the UI or its buggy or all this stuff. You have no idea how refreshing and awesome it is to get in your car or just go into an office next door right now and enter a friggin' draft. Okay? Because remember the days when you're sitting at the store being, oh my God, we have three. Can we just three more. We'll just draft to a six. Can we just get... And you're calling people, you know, you're like, hey, you want to come draft? I'm getting even more old school for you. I used to sit at Superstars, the precursor... Yeah. And page people, because nobody had cell phones, okay? And like, hey, you want to come draft? You know, paging to the store and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, like, Magic before Magic Online was just a totally different world.
Oh, yeah.
And, I mean, we still wanted to play Magic Online. We used to play on, like, some of the fake clients, like Apprentice.
Yes.
There's a couple other ones.
We all did that, yeah.
Like, there's one called Cockatrice right now. Like, they're the unofficial, like, Magic plays ways of playing Magic. There's also a way of drafting. There was an app called... Net draft.
This is very old. Right, you're in the Wayback Machine now.
We used to like meet on IRC. This will date me. And then we'd set up like a server for net draft and then play an apprentice.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, like fast forward to now. Obviously, Magic Online is showing not just age, but also kind of just a sensibility that isn't very like modern.
Yeah, let's be honest. It hasn't innovated.
Yeah,
and that's the beauty of Magic. Magic's a great product. Sells itself. Don't have to innovate. Only now, with competition in the marketplace, other games look so gorgeous when you play them. And it's not much. It's just little frills here and there, but you're like, oh my gosh, this is great.
Look, the thing I'm looking forward to most in like Magic Arena is actually not the UI. It's not the visuals. It's the fact that the promise of being able to play like on mobile,
mm-hmm.
like playing on a tablet, on your phone, like... That is the thing that I'm missing now. Like, I can't play it on the train. I only can play it, like, if I have a PC specifically. I can't even play on a Mac. And so the big advantage of, like, being on, like, mobile, which is the biggest platform, or, like, tablet, is that you can kind of take it anywhere. And you can't do that right now. And you can do that with other things like Hearthstone and mm-hmm. things like that. And I think it's time that Magic is able to be played, like, competitively. I mean, obviously, they had things like... Duels,
right?
But Duels was a kind of a pale imitation of what Magic is.
It's a great way to learn, though.
Oh yeah,
it's a great way to learn. So, but if you're watching Magic TV, you already know how to play Magic. But Duels is a fantastic. I mean, you know, I gave it to my wife. I'm like, here, try this, and it's much better. Particularly if you play a lot of Magic, you think about so many. You never think about everything going through your head with every draw and every step. Until you try to explain it to someone.
Yeah.
You
know? So I mean, Magic Arena, the promise of it is that it's a fully, like, full engine, like, game. So there's, like, priorities and timing exactly the same way as it is in Paper Magic. But you're able to play with a better UI, a much more smooth kind of interface. But they are only starting with Ixalan. So I think it will take a while for them to actually get to a stage where it's actually going to have all the cards that are going to be for standard. One thing I'm really looking forward to is like drafting, because drafting is so much better. Kind of like
it's not going to go backwards, right? It's just going to be Ixalan forward.
They kind of left the door open a little bit. They've talked about like we're going to start off Ixalan. I think they're worried about having to go too far back. Like Magic Online goes all the way back to Alpha. I wouldn't be surprised if they go all the way back to Modern, because it looks like, especially with some of the things we're going to talk about later, they're reinvesting in old cards and old formats. And I think Modern will be the kind of way that they like capture a little bit more of Magic's history. Because I think it would be a little bit kind of, I don't know, it's not quite Magic if it's only Ixalan forward. And I hope they actually go back in time. Probably won't go further back than Modern.
Mm-hmm.
But if they go back to Modern, that's not bad.
And it'll take a while.
It'll take a while.
So let
it's
me
a
tell
lot
you,
of sense.
They keep referencing, and I'm sure this the platform they built it on, which is clearly meant to be able to expand to mobile. I can't remember what it's called.
Unity,
right? Okay, Unity was it? And I just they kept saying, I was like, that must be important. That must be mobile. But let me share my hidden fear with you, TBS.
Okay.
And I guess it'll no longer be hidden because I'm about to share it with all of you as well. I cannot. It is inexplicable to me to even roll out a beta that's not tablet and phone enabled. And it, and what that says to me, because I think that's almost just common sense, that maybe they were under the gun to get this out. Hascon was coming and they had to get it out. And so now I have this like deep-seated fear the product's not ready. And I don't think we as digital magic gamers, I mean, you and I were immune to this because we're really not going to get discouraged, but the world at large could get discouraged. And I am very fearful of that.
So I will say that I'm not that fearful of it. A couple reasons. Hearthstone actually had the exact same rollout. It started off only on PC. I think they had Mac as well. Before they had like the tablet versions.
I did not know that. So yeah. What was the gap period? Do you remember?
Quite a long time. Like, okay. We're talking about like 6 to 12 months. I can't remember exactly, but okay.
I won't panic for 12 months.
And even then, even when they actually released on I think they released the iPad first. They didn't have the phone version for a year.
I do remember that. I remember you could get it from. But you know what? Here's the other thing too: is that was a different world. We're further along now.
We are.
It's never, you know, you can't hold yourself by the standards of what they did a number of years ago. That being said, I feel a little bit better about things. But I thought the big announcement was going to be here it is, and by the way, you can play it on your phone, and that just would have been that would have been amazing.
I think the difference is they should have started off with tablet, tablet phone.
Yes.
Like rather than starting off with PC, like the platform that is the biggest, the platform that can handle the most like people is like tablet, and you'd be able to find out how successful the product can be. That being said, there is some kind of difference between how something interacts with mouse and keyboard mm-hmm. compared to like tap and touch. Mm-hmm. So I think one thing a lot of people who are not kind of in game development don't realize is like how a player interacts with the screen and things like that is very, very different from like platform to platform. Even like in some cases, Android to iOS is actually a little bit different. Now, what the good thing is they're on Unity. Unity is kind of this game creation engine mm-hmm. That you can do a lot of stuff with. You can make shooters, you can make like RTSs, you can also make TCGs. And it's built to be multi-platform. So I'm not worried about like the back-end kind of infrastructure that allows them to make kind of the platform. I am worried that they may not do the nuances of making something for a tablet, making something for a phone, making something for a PC. I think it's a little bit kind of, there's a lot of nuances there.
What's your favorite, we'll close on this. What's your favorite game that's made the jump to tablet, from PC to tablet?
Oh, that's hard. I mean, I think Hearthstone is really good at doing that. I mean, you know, I think a lot of Magic players play Hearthstone as well, kind of because they don't have like a Magic on tablet. Mm-hmm. I think the thing is Hearthstone is created for like an interaction and a balance that's good for tablet. It's like it's tablet first. Mm-hmm. I see some things in Magic Arena that indicate they're thinking about it that way, but I'll hold my kind of
any
judgment.
Any non-tablet first games?
Like I've played a little bit of PlayerUnknown's Battlegrounds, which is kind of the hit thing. I'm not really a MOBA player like a lot of my friends are. Mm-hmm. But you know, like one of my favorite games. I mean, I think one of the most perfectly designed games is Portal and the Portal 2. For those fans out there, that game's awesome. If you want to go way back, at least I love adventure games like, you know, Curse of Monkey Island, if you want to go way, way back.
Is that available on a tablet now?
That is available on a tablet now.
I will go way, way back, and I think it might even be the same era. You know what's a great jump to tablet and phone? Knights of the Old Republic.
Oh, yeah.
Have you played that on your tablet?
I haven't played it on a tablet.
Oh, my God. I downloaded really it, good. And I like, replayed it, flying to GP, like, international GPs. You can play it for hours. And I was really skeptical that, and this just goes to what you were saying about having to make that jump from using the mouse and everything, and the keyboard to like using the touch stuff, and it actually did a great job at it. I was really, really. By the way, if you have not played Knights of the Old Republic either on your computer or on your tablet, it's dated now. At the time, it blew my mind. It was like the most amazing game ever. But it's a great. I think it costs like $10 to download it. I'm telling you, it's well worth it and replayable. So, all right, high hopes for Arena. I think we're Absolutely. All super duper excited about it. It is living the dream if we could play Magic on our phones.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Like, that would be just unbelievable.
Oh, yeah. No, drafting. It'd be great.
Yeah, it'd be unbelievable. So, fingers crossed. Okay, speaking of old school, let's talk about Iconic Masters. There was a super duper uber pre-release of Iconic Masters at Hascon, one of the things that Wizards did, and I thought this was, I really kind of appreciated this old school, they kept all the spoilers under lock and key for Iconic Masters, because that's how it used to be, you know. We didn't know what was in the set until we started opening packs, right. You know. And so they wanted that old school flavor, and so they did that. They did a good job with it. As many leaks as we've had to deal with in recent memory, Iconic Masters really, really was kind of kept under wraps very, very well until they rolled it out at Hascon.
Yeah, I mean, it was exciting because, I mean, as you said, they kept it pretty well under wraps. I think it's a combination of they didn't say much.
Yep.
It wasn't like they said, hey, this is going to be this exciting thing. Mm-hmm. They actually just didn't advertise it a lot. And so that in that way, it was a little bit mysterious because no one talked about it. But they really, really surprised people with like a reprint that some people predicted, but I mean, a lot of people thought they would never do it.
Mana Drain?
Mana Drain. I mean, Mana Drain is like
crazy. It's
insane.
It's definitely iconic. Yep. So I think they got that part right. And it's... You always got to have a little something, right, to, like, raise the eyebrow, like, ooh, Mana Drain.
I mean, Mana Drain was over $200, I think. It's almost $300, like, it was, like, before Iconic Masters. Now I think it's closer to $200, and I think the new one is, like, $150, $160. I don't know exactly where it's going to kind of, shake out, but it's, like, it's a pretty cool card to get it.
All right, wait, we just got a comment here saying the new art for Mana Drain, it's on the Twitch feed here, is amazing.
Okay. Armando,
Big Worm's all about new art, first of all. So your opinion, Armando, it means nothing in this debate. If it's new and shiny, you like it, so that doesn't matter. The old art for Mana Drain is unbelievable.
Oh, it's so good. Now, if you ask me, what is it actually depicting? I don't know. But the thing is, there's something about the art that makes you kind of like wonder what it is. Whereas literally the picture on the new Mana Drain is a sink of color.
Yeah.
Okay. They said, like, how are we gonna do Mana Drain? What if we do a drain with mana? It's like, oh my god.
So unreal. Yeah.
It's so literal. Like, come on, Armando.
Mana Drain is mana draining because what does Mana Drain look like? The original Mana Drain, right? That's what Mana Drain looks like. This is like, yeah, I don't know, like water swishing in a toilet bowl. Yeah. Who knows what it is? But, you know, it's. Definitely the marquee card of the set, right?
Yes.
And obviously it's what we open with when we talk about it. I mean, Mana Drain used to have a drawback when mana could burn you. And I wonder if here's a spoiler, kiddies. It wasn't really a drawback back then. Now we don't even have to worry about that. It's just Mana Drain is just a strictly superior counterspell. It is just better than counterspell.
It is. I think the one weird thing about Mana Drain is it's not legal in Legacy. It is not good enough to be played a lot in Vintage. It is played some.
Yeah.
But there's something about the card that people love, and there's a lot of great memories. I mean, I Mana Drained into Mirror Universe a lot in my lifetime.
Oh, my God.
But it's kind of weird. Like, it still has this kind of...
It's iconic.
It's iconic.
It is iconic. Without it is really, you know... we love to criticize Wizards for things. This is a home run. This is the perfect card for this set. They're able to reprint it. It's not on the reserve list. They don't have to worry about injecting something into any kind of format where, oh my gosh, it's going to be awful because it doesn't get played that much in Vintage, and it's banned in Legacy, and it is definitely iconic. So that's a home run. I mean, Necro's in the set.
Right.
We've seen Necro a few times now. There's no doubt Necro is iconic.
I wish it was the skull picture.
Skull. Okay, yeah. Come on, Big Worm. The Necro skull is the best picture, isn't it? The Necro skull is the skull as we called it back in the day. I gotta say those, and I don't want to be nitpicky, but that's what we do. We pick nits. Yeah. Mythic?
No, I think. I mean, if you look at and think about like what makes a Mythic card now? I think Mythic is fine for these cards. I mean, obviously, they need to make something Mythic because the old cards didn't have Mythic. I mean,
should this card... I mean,
Necro?
I'm not saying it's not Mythic in feel. There's a lot of Necros out there. There's a lot of Ice Age Necro. I mean, you know, I don't think they should reprint it. This is a set that's called Iconic Masters. They're bringing back icons. And I almost feel like we lost a Mythic spot making this Mythic. They could have made it rare. It would have been fine.
Yeah,
People going to be pulling their hair out about, you just tanked the value of my Necro?
No, I actually think part of like some of the rarities... This is weird. Iconic Masters is it's a Masters, but it's not like some of the card choices they've made in the non kind of Mythic area, like make it make me think that they're trying to make a limited playable set.
Oh, there's no question about that, right? There's absolutely no question they're doing that. I wonder. And this is the thing that, you know, again, I think the set's fantastic. I'm going to be critical here because I think that makes a better conversation about the set. I think the set is fantastic. Awesome. I'm super excited. I actually think it's going to be fun to draft because I think they did put that thought in there. Yeah. But I'm still a Magic player, which means I have my
criticisms. I don't want to open Necro for my limited games. It's like not very good in limited. It's really hard to cast.
You're passing that. You're not taking that in limited. What are you talking about? It's not very good in limited.
It's not good in limited.
I know. You're passing it.
Right.
There's no way you take it.
No, but what I mean by making it Mythic is that it doesn't turn up enough, so it doesn't kind of screw up a little bit of the limited.
If you make it a... I mean, come on. I'm saying make it a rare. I'm not saying... don't even make it uncommon. Make it rare.
Right.
I would love... So they make all the Praetors are in here.
Yep.
Right. Okay. Elesh, Norn, Jinja, Tax is probably the two most popular for all of you that remember the Praetors. They all saw a run, but they don't really. I mean, Elesh kind of feels iconic. I think she's the only one that feels iconic to me.
Jinja Taxus is in some of the reanimated decks, so I can kind of.
I can picture Elesh Norn. Now, granted, that's because of that Elesh V token we had, which always comes to mind. Elesh Norn's iconic. Jinja Taxus, maybe. Shieldred, Urabask, Vorinclex, get out of here. I know not every card in the set can be iconic. I'm just talking about the mythics, and we know they'll put one or two of a cycle. Prime time's in there all alone.
It's true.
Do I think the Gravefather is more iconic than Urabask, Shieldred, Vorinclex, and even Jinja Taxus? No question.
Yeah, I mean, look, not all of these are home runs. Some of these are not even bunts.
And we already got into this. If we're talking iconic, there's still Chromium, Palladium Morris. Arcady Sabbath. I mean, those are iconic. Now, again, I'm showing my age here, but those cards were iconic.
Look at Nicol Bolas.
Is Shivan Dragon in here?
Shivan Dragon is in here, I think.
Is
I'm pretty sure Shivan Dragon's in here. We can have a quick look, but I'm pretty sure Shivan Dragon is in here. I mean, I think it's a tough ask because it's a full set. I think it's 250 cards, and they're trying to get some cards that are like obviously really, really get people excited. But remember, they've had 3 Modern Masters now, so they've reprinted a lot of cards that people might consider iconic. And they've had it in Eternal Masters.
That's Modern Forward, and that's why I feel a little bit of license to go a little more old school here, because I think a lot of stuff like Tarmogoyf is clearly iconic.
Yeah,
Tarmogoyf is iconic. It's not in here, you know. It's in Modern. You know, Wizards.
They have Modern cards in here, though.
Right. Wizards is in a tough place because what do you sell out for the iconic, or do you sell out for? I don't mean sell out as in doing something negative. I mean, what's your theme here? Are you really pushing the icon part? Shivan Dragon not in, by the way.
Okay.
Very iconic, right? Original art? Can we get original art? Shivan Dragon?
So to be fair to them, there's a couple things. One, I think the art is what makes some cards iconic. And the reason why they don't use the old art is actually for legal reasons. They actually don't have like ownership over all that original art. So I think in some cases what they want to do is like kind of standardize how the art looks like when they reprint cards.
Well, I have a little bit of insight here. There's, you know, the art, there's an art direction, a very clear art direction within the company now, and they want to bring things in line with the art direction, and that's why we see things. You know, the legal term we're looking for is the rights to that art are what we call in a fuzzy area, and it's kind of unclear who owns what, whether the original artists own it or whether Wizards own it in conjunction, whatever. Let's not get into that. But you're right, bringing Shivan Dragon back in without the original art makes it hurt. I agree with that. There's some other stuff, even if we get a little bit newer, that I think is fairly iconic. If I think of iconic cards, Flame Tongue Kavu, that feels pretty iconic to me. Psychotog?
Sure.
Feels pretty Wild Mongrel? I mean, that's not even like a...
Okay, I mean, we talked about this before we actually went to air, but there's another Masters set next year. It's Masters...
25th anniversary Masters.
Right, whatever, yeah. And I think what they probably had a really tough like challenge, because I think M25, or what do you want to call it, Masters 25, they're going to have cards from the entire run of Magic. It's almost iconic Masters 2.
Yeah.
Right?
I agree.
And so I think they probably split the history of Magic into two sets. They wanted to have another set because I think reprinting is something that they realize one is very lucrative. Like, I think, you know, makes money, and that's fine. I actually want that to happen. I actually think there is a real balance between making old formats like accessible and keeping the value of cards. I actually think that I think it's in their best interest to actually just make more of these cards. So I think that's okay.
I agree.
And they don't want to use all the cards like early. They want to make other massive sets in the future.
Well, so the theme for the 25th anniversary is supposed to, I think it maybe would be more in line with what I'm suggesting, where you are going to bring back maybe more standard powerhouses to bring back the flavor of what was great in a certain era of Magic, rather than the iconic overall. But that's going to be Psychotog is pretty iconic. I'll get you another one that's very iconic, not in here. And I don't want this to turn into like a... this was supposed to be a preview, and all I'm doing is talking about what's not in this set. Counterspell.
Yeah.
Counterspell's one of the most iconic. And we got Mana Drain, we got Mana Leak, and those are both extremely iconic too. I think Mana Leak is
I will bet any amount of money that Counterspell's in Masters 25.
You think so?
I think so. Okay. And all the cards that we talked about, we're going to go, oh, okay, that's why they did that. And I think that's fair enough.
So we'll reserve judgment. One of the things that definitely was another eye-raising thing, Flusterstorm.
Yeah.
Reprinted at Rare.
I think that's really good. I think that any time that they can put into circulation some of the cards that like appeared in Commander or some of the other kind of like boutique sets, like these cards get a lot of play in Legacy, and their price is so high to play it. Like, and like Legacy is a really fun format. I wish more people could play it. I honestly wish more people had Dual Lands so they could play it. And I think it's unfair to have a card like Flusterstorm and like True Name Nemesis for that matter, to own, like, got reprinted once or maybe twice, and exists not in any booster set.
Right, you can't. Yeah.
And I think that's eventually. I think they want to move all the stuff that they don't do in booster sets into a booster set at some point. And I think this is a pretty good way of doing it.
I think it's a good way to do it. And I'm happy. I'm not invested in Flusterstorm, so it was a good thing for me. Obviously, I think some people were not too happy, particularly those that had Flusterstorms. It was one of the eye-raising things in the set. Mishra's Bauble.
Yeah.
We get Mishra's Bauble in here.
That's good too.
That needed a reprint pretty badly. We really needed more of those.
I mean, that was like a $20 or $30 uncommon. Or common? I can't remember it. But like,
it's common.
It's common?
Yeah.
It was a very expensive common. I don't know. Like,
I think it was... No, is it common?
I think it might be uncommon.
I think it's uncommon. Yeah, you're right.
But
it's uncommon.
But, I mean, you know, they hit some of the notes. I mean, what's the name of this company?
What's the name of the channel? Fireball in there.
Yes.
You can, if you play your cards right, you can channel Fireball. If you don't open that channel and you get a Mana Drain, maybe you Mana Drain Fireball. and both of these things can happen, and both of them are awesome. But yeah, channel and Fireball are in there. So, you know, you can live the dream.
Oh, yeah.
Someone was sending us pictures. There was I don't know if it was Chaos Sealed or Chaos Underworld. They had a revised starter pack, and someone had a Channel Fireball, and they started sending us pictures of their Channel Fireball, which is awesome. That's unbelievable. Always good. The Kamigawa Dragons are back, and a little bit less exciting. Fun for Limited. This is like the only Kaiga and Kokusho are like maybe Yosei.
Yeah, I mean they're not. None of them are good.
Jugen and Ryusei saw some play.
There's a little bit of a dragon theme. There's quite a lot of dragon synergies.
Yes. Which I think itself is very iconic in Magic. There's angels too. Like Archangel Thune's in, Sarah Angel's in, Restoration Angel. Angels and dragon, you know, they're very, very iconic in terms of, you know, Magic. And that's why originally Shiva Dragon and Sarah Angel were huge chase cards. Glimpse the Unthinkable. Which I'm glad to see in there. That's always been a card that...
It's a big casual card.
Yeah, people love it.
Yeah.
And it's a sweet card. It's actually a very sweet card. I will say this. The Future Sight lands. You only printed Prime Time. Okay, so you did need to reprint all of them. And I agree that four of them needed to be reprinted. I think we have plenty of Graven Cairns at this point. We have plenty of Graven Cairns. Original art Graven Cairns, by the way. Best art Graven Cairns. But it is nice to see those Lorwyn lands, which I always love. Now, obviously, Horizon Canopy and Grove of the Burnwellows are amazing.
Horizon Canopy was a really needed reprint too.
A Grove too. I mean, they need more Groves. But the River of Tears, which is I can't remember what it is. Like if it's your turn, it's black mana.
It's your turn. It's black. Their turn's blue.
Blue. I loved that mechanic. I thought that was such a great idea. I remember it blew my mind when Future Sight came out. I was like, this is awesome. And you know, the thing about Future Sight is, are they ever going to see print in a normal, you know, Type 2 set? I don't know that it will.
No, I mean, like, it's possible they may create a cycle out of River of Tears or something like that. Because they did that with Graven Cairns. Graven Cairns is like the first of a cycle.
It's the only one they did.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think they'll do Grove. I think Grove is kind of like a little bit too broken as a mechanic. It seems like it's kind of fair because it's like Carpluzin but reversed.
Yeah.
But it's not really as fair because some decks don't even care.
Yeah, you don't care about the resource. You're not leaving it up. And what about Horizon Canopy? Can we see a cycle of Horizon Canopies, Ben?
I hope not.
I mean, that's ridiculous. There's no way you could do that.
Horizon Canopy is really good. I mean, it's kind of like a cycling land, except that it's 50 times better.
It's kind of like I
cycling from play. That's what it is.
Okay. Any other cards you want to touch on in this set?
No, I think it's nice having these sets. I do actually like the down pressure they put on prices of cards.
Oh, I love that.
I mean, Magic is meant, it's better when more people get to play it. Mm-hmm. Now, I agree. Like, look, I have a collection, you know, like plenty of stuff, like, you know, went down in price for me as well. But, like, it doesn't really matter ultimately because I have my cards to play. And I think Wizards are making it very clear that they want, you know, cards to play. They want people to play the game rather than sit on cards and try and speculate. I think, and that's a good idea.
And I think, you know, I'll say this for those who kind of want to take issue with that. Two things. One, reprints have an effect where, you know, what happens often is the price goes down and it buoys back up. And sometimes it hits where it was before. So the losses you may see now are you know, not permanent in many ways. And two, if reprints for anything, and Modern is a great example of this. If reprints open the door to more players playing with those cards that you're like, oh my gosh, my Flusterstorm just took a hit, but now more people are playing Legacy, which means more people want Flusterstorms, and they aren't printing a million of them. Long term, it's better for Magic.
Yeah.
It's better for your collection. It's better for everyone. So, you know, obviously, I work at Channel Fireball. So, you know, I don't, and I do not have a huge collection. Just cards I have a queue. And I don't believe Flusterstorm's in that queue. So, you know, I have no dog in the hunt there. But more people playing Magic is just objectively good if you're a Magic player.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, ever since they really started kind of pushing kind of, you know, things like Modern and stuff like that, like, Magic's grown.
Yeah.
And that's a good thing.
And to be honest with you, the proof's almost in the pudding. How many of you out there that are watching, or if you're watching this on Facebook, YouTube, channelfireball.com, however you're watching this, you can put this in the comments. Facebook chat we can't see, but in the Twitch chat and the YouTube chat we can see. How many of you out there watching, you can leave it in a comment afterwards, really, really take issue with the reserve, with the idea that they could ever undo the reserve list? Because everyone I talk to is like, please, please, please get rid of the reserve list. Please, we'd love it if you did. And I know there's collectors out there, and I know that some of you have invested a lot of money in Magic, and I'm not saying that it's without pain. And you know, every time we talk about this, we find a structure where it's like, let's find a path to get rid of the reserve list in the next 3 years or 5 years or whatever it is. But I haven't really met a player. Actually, I haven't met a player. I haven't talked to anyone in years who comes up and says, hey, you know what? I'm a huge fan of the reserve list. They better never get rid of it.
Yeah, I think it's only people real. The only people who want a reserve list are the people who's like, you know, have a lot of money there. And look, I totally understand, like, if you have a lot of money there. But I think in general, I mean, some of the best Magic is played in Vintage. Some of the best Magic is played in Legacy. And I don't think that should be the main format, but I would love more people to play it. And I think that more people would really enjoy, like, Magic if they had access and could feel, for want of a better word, the power of these cards. It's so fun.
More people playing Magic is just, I already said it once, it's just objectively better for the game, for all of us.
Yep.
So, if you're, let me know. If you are someone who's like, hey, Mosh, you got it wrong about the reserve list, we need to keep it in place, I would love to hear from you, because I actually just don't know anyone at this point.
I do think that there are kind of some things that, like, there are knock-on effects. I think, like, having the reserve makes people feel that they can invest in Magic as a long-term hobby. Like, as in, like, oh, like, at least I can get some of my money back. So I'm not saying it's actually without risk, though I think we should probably err on the side of more reprints than less reprints.
I think the risk is minimal. I think...
How about gold border? Because what if they just gold bordered, like, sets?
So two things. One, I think if they reprinted Moxes and Lotuses tomorrow, new art, obviously, new borders, new set, people... people are still going to pine for the originals. People are still going to pine for those. You know, nothing you're going to do is going to replace that.
Yeah, because they're going to put new art and like, you know, satisfy people like Armando.
People like Big Worm over here are going to love it. But and then two, I'm glad you brought up the gold border, boy. We got to get to Ixalan here in a bit. But one of the things that noodled around in my brain when I heard about Iconic Masters, and of course we're gamers, so I think this would go over really, really well for like you and I. But I wonder what kind of buy-in everyone else would have. So I'll pose it to you. What if they had a set like Iconic Masters and just said, gold border, we'll put it in packs, you can draft it, and we'll have rarities and stuff like this, but there's going to be some crazy stuff in here, and it's gold. It's not tournament legal, it's gold border. So it's basically open it and draft it.
Yeah, or play it at home.
Play it at home. And, I mean, the reason Wizards, you know, like, and this is where I think it's a great idea. I would love this. And I think Channel Fireball President and CEO John Sasso would love it. Would Channel Fireball love it? Probably not, because what happens, these cards may or may not have collectible value. It could damage the value, right, if there's a lot of them. Because they're going to be used as proxies. They're going to be used in cubes everywhere. And that, you know, that's fine. I mean, wouldn't it be great to just have a set like that with all this crazy stuff in it that we could open for draft?
Yeah,
I think we'd sell packs.
Yeah, I think it's worth considering. I'd be shocked if they hadn't considered it. I think it's still probably on the table in someone's mind. As a, you know, kind of a bullet in the chamber, like, if it's, hey, you know what, we need to, like, you know, reconsider this whole reserve list thing, maybe in the future.
I don't think that they will ever be reprinting, because I just don't think there's gonna be any gold border cards out ever again. Yeah. I don't. Silver border is different, because silver border cards are insane, and they're not reprints.
I mean, but what if you just made silver border Black Lotus? I mean,
I'm all for it. Let's do it. Okay. So, but the idea is out there, and I'd love to hear your feedback on this. All you out there, you can leave it in the comments. Let us know in the chat. Now, what if they did have a set? But basically, is, hey, this is a set for drafting. No. You cannot play this. It's not tournament playable and constructed. But by gosh, it's going to be your best experience drafting. Yeah. Is that something you'd run out there and buy? It'd also be for your cubes, obviously.
Oh, yeah,
if it's good and limited, it's really. I think that'd be amazing.
I think it'd be good.
I think it would be, but then you see, you and I are pretty skewed, because I think we would just go through it and draft it, care.
I mean, look, if they just had that set and it, like, literally as soon as I drafted it disappeared, like it just, like, went into the air.
Like maybe it was a digital game. Yeah. It just dissipated when
I would play that. Like, yeah. I do like playing this. It's the experience of playing them. I do think that, you know, people do want to have those cards to proxy or to play in cubes and stuff like that. I don't know. I don't have Magic as a sacred cow collector. Like,
I don't think, no one really does that anymore.
I don't think
some people have tons of jewelry. I get that. But, I mean, can we skew all this stuff? I'm telling you, I think it's a very small minority.
Yeah,
I mean, I know it is.
Oh, okay. I think it is, but I think they're worried about the perception of what it's a floodgate thing. It's like, if this thing topples, what else changes?
They could reprint Tarmogoyf. They could reprint Dark Confidant.
Yeah.
They could reprint, you know, it's like, do we care? No. Do we really care? Anyway, okay, that's a topic for another time. Ixalan Limited Impressions, the second topic on today's Magic TV.
We're going to go through these next three topics pretty quickly.
I warned you. I want to be fair to everyone. Before we went live, I warned Armando, I warned TBS, and I asked Darksteel Humphrey if it was okay if we spent a lot of time on Iconic Masters.
I think a lot of people there's a lot of Ixalan articles, CFB, channelfireball.com has so many articles for Ixalan. Yeah. So I don't really kind of like add too much to what we're going to be talking about, but I think, you know, all this old stuff and, you know, digital magic is really, really important stuff, and I love talking about it.
Yeah.
But Ixalan's coming out, pre-releases this weekend.
Are you playing?
Next
weekend?
No, it's this weekend.
It's this weekend. Yeah.
It is this weekend. I probably will play, like, one.
Are you going to the Channel Fireball Game Center?
Maybe.
All right, check out the CFBGC. Channel Fireball Game Center. It starts at midnight, which is, like, one of our most popular. So, like, 11:59 Thursday night that we run midnight flights, and I think for a while those were the most popular.
Yeah, I mean, people really want to get hands on those cards. I really like the look of this set. I think this set is actually pretty inventive and flavorful and just a little different. So a couple things that they've kind of done about this set, which is a bit different. So there's four tribes. Usually with tribal sets, they have, like, one per color.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of doing that, they just said, like, what are the four tribes we want? And then they actually made sure that every color had two tribes. So how do you do that? Well, you have 2 3-color tribes and 2 2-color tribes, which actually turns the set combination of Ravnica and shards.
Let me stop you here just for a second. How many of you actually noticed that? Because I'm just going to be honest. I did not notice that. I did not know this, like, 3-color tribe, 2-color tribe, everybody has 2. That is just not something that escaped my notice looking at the set. So this is why we have TBS on here. Anyway, continue. Just be honest with yourself. Just let me know if you caught that, because I certainly didn't. And, I mean...
Yeah. So I think it's really, really smart design, because I think changing it up is important. I think people like wedges and shards, and people like guilds.
Guilds, yeah.
So... It's kind of like this mashing together. So the dinosaurs are Naya, mm-hmm. The pirates are Grixis,
which makes sense.
Yeah, like I think those are all really, really good. And then the merfolk are Simic, and the vampires are Orzhov.
And it's really weird to see the green merfolk.
Oh yeah,
I can't. It's something about it.
Hey, Guy of Skyfolk, you remember that?
I do remember that Miracle-Gro, the original Miracle-Gro.
Guy of Skyfolk, yes. Original merfolk green creature. But what I think the cool thing is, while the 2-3 color ones are kind of like they're wedges, mm-hmm. they're also 3 different like tribes inside. There's actually like a blue black pirate tribe, a red black pirate tribe, yeah. and a blue red pirate tribe. So it's almost like a Ravnica redux. There's only 2 color combinations that don't exist, like in pairs. It's like one is green black. And one is blue-white. So I wonder if Rivals of Ixalan actually will have, like, some...
So Golgari and Azorius are missing.
They don't really have an identity, which is kind of weird. So,
Big Worm, be honest. Did you know any of this before TBS said it?
New dragons with 3 colors.
Oh, come on. Yeah,
dinosaurs.
You mean dinosaurs? how many 3-color dragons are in the set again?
Land dragons.
Yeah.
Land dragons.
Come on. By the way, that is very confusing. It's only the feathers that distinguish them, right? Like, that's how we know. There's feathers on it, it's a dinosaur. There's no feathers, apparently it's a dragon.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, I actually think they did pretty well with the flavor of the dinosaurs. The dinosaurs are generally big and dumb. They have different synergies. One of them is, like, enrage, which is, like, doing damage to themselves. And one is, like, toughness, which is a green-white dinosaur. And then the red-white ones are kind of, like... They're the swarm deck.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and they look cool. I like.
Yeah. So the 3 dinosaur tribes have some things, and then the blue black pirates are about treasure.
Mm-hmm.
The red black ones are about attacking because that's red black.
But they're still about treasure, just attacking first.
Right. And then I guess the blue red ones are about. I'll call it card flow. I can't pin it down, but they're about like making sure you have the right things at the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And so. But they're all about raid, so all about like making sure that you get into the combat phase and getting through. And so I think they did really good kind of what is the thing that defines pirates, and then what the thing does define all the individual pieces of pirates.
Mm-hmm.
And so I really like this set. I think it's interesting. Some people have talked about the power level of like certain cards. I actually think we heard the same thing with Aether Revolt. And Aether Revolt happened to have plenty of good cards.
Yes.
I think we heard some with Armaket. I think Armaket had plenty of good cards. I really think that people have over kind of stated what powerful is. And I think the current standard will actually bear out these cards are going to be pretty impactful, especially with a big rotation that has just happened.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough. I mean, Fatal Push, I mean, we'll talk about impactful. That's got to be like one of the most impactful cards printed, you know, in a while. Fatal Push is pretty crazy. But what are your thoughts kind of just... We've broken down the sets of colors. What are you looking? So you show up, you're at the Channel Fireball Game Center, you're ready to pre-release, and you say to yourself, all right, TBS, I hope I open something in...
I mean, I always, like the pre-release, look at my rares, and I'll just build a deck around the rares.
Yeah, but I mean, you have all these themes. What theme would you like to be? Because like for me, I always, in Limited, I like to just... In constructed too. I don't know why I said limited, but I want to be aggressive. I can play control poorly in constructed. Playing control in limited is just nerve wracking. I really don't like it.
Yeah, I mean I just like the weirdest cards. I think in pre-releases are the chance for me to play cards that look like I don't know how good they are. And so if I see like a weird card in a set, it's like okay, like some of the transform cards in the new set. They're all interesting, and we don't know how good or how easy they are to flip over. I think that's the kind of card I really like opening. So it's something that challenges me about, I know I've played Magic for so long, I know kind of how good a 4-4-4-4 is, so I don't really... I mean...
That has changed, though, since the dawn of Magic.
That's fair.
A 4-4-4-4 used to be really good, and now 4-4-4 is like...
That's true. Yeah. But even considering that, I think, you know, if my aggro deck is really good, I'll build an aggro deck. I'm not saying I'll force it, but I will look for things that are a little bit unusual, some of the themes that I haven't seen before. I don't know. I mean, I like the exploration. I'm a bit of a, I guess they call it a Johnny, kind of, I like the pieces and see how it goes together.
This is always kind of the fun time. The format hasn't been established. Yeah. You can do what you want. Because... I get it. You can always draft. You can always play. So you can always do what you want. But once we have a defined metagame, we feel constrained.
Yep.
How many times have you sat there with a sealed pool? Or how many times have you, been on one strategy in a draft and then just look at something and said, I got to play that. I've got to play that.
Yep.
You don't really have to play it. But you know that's the archetype. You know that's the format. But right now, for these next few weeks, this is this golden moment where you get to decide what you want to do. Now, maybe that means you're going to go out there and get crushed. But a lot of that agency starts to leave us, right? Where we feel so constrained, I opened this, so I've got to play it, you know?
One of the things I do like about pre-releases, and something I usually look forward to, is that pre-releases are meant to be lower intensity. So you're playing against people who sometimes only have played four tournaments a year. They just play pre-releases.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to, I play competitively. I played Grand Prix and Pro Tours and stuff like that. But I don't want to turn my opponent's experience into something negative or very, rules lawyery or something like that. So what the way I do it is I change the challenge for myself. It's I'm going to handicap myself because I want to have fun as well. And by me having fun, actually the players who aren't as proficient or who don't play as much tournaments, they also have fun because they go, wow, I didn't even think about these kind of things. Mm-hmm. And so I think a lot of people who do go to pre-releases should change, I think, your attitude about it's not a tournament like a PPTQ or an RPTQ
There's no real upside to winning. It's not about
The
pre-releases are great. When pre-releases are done right, it's about playing Magic.
Yeah.
I know, novel concept, but it's about playing Magic.
Yeah.
You're not winning the golden ticket. You're not fighting it on the Pro Tour. You're not playing for cash. There's a prize. There's always prizes. We play the game for prizes. But it is about, I think... This pre-releases in particular. If you haven't played in a pre-release, honestly, and particularly if you're I'm kind of nervous, I play on the kitchen table, or I'm a commander player, or I just play casual with my friends, pre-releases are the tournaments for you. And you should go check it out. It's just more about fun. Everybody, and that disadvantage you get if you're making the leap from the kitchen table to a standard tournament, or from commander to a standard tournament, or from always playing standard to modern, or whatever jump you're making, everybody's fresh. Yeah. Everyone can go online, look at the cards, but they haven't played with them yet. This is everybody's first chance. Like I just said, the archetypes aren't set. So honestly, it's time to do it. And if you are someone who plays a lot of competitive Magic, don't go there and be a gunner. Don't be that guy. Don't be that girl. Don't be that person, that's going to go out there and make this super competitive. Pre-releases are for fun. Remember when you played Magic just for funsies? that's kind of what it is. It's for funsies. And if you can't do that, you know what? Honestly, forget everything I just said about going to the pre-release. Just don't do it.
Yeah.
Just don't do it. I don't want to discourage anyone from playing Magic. You should play Magic, but that's not where you should be playing Magic. You should be, play somewhere else. It's one weekend. It's 4 weekends a year. Pre-releases are great. They're so fun, and they're really about fun. They're not about winning. So that's it. That's my PSA on
pre-release. No, I agree. And make sure the experience is good for your opponents. Mm-hmm. I think one of the things, that I like doing is talk to my opponents, find out where they're from, how long they've been playing, how they enjoy Magic. And mm-hmm. some of my best friends I've met playing pre-releases because, normally you see the same folk playing the tough tournaments, but you see new people playing pre-releases. Mm-hmm. I think that's pretty cool.
It's great. Two quick stories about pre-releases. I know we're running short on time. One, we used to, when Luis was local, he would come and gunsling at all of our pre-releases. And he'd have a sealed deck, he'd have a standard deck. And of course, he was Luis. He had won Berlin. He'd come in second at Kyoto. There was a period of time where he was undefeated. And he had won at two or three California GPs. He was undefeated in California, North, California GPs. It was ridiculous. He's also, LSV, Hall of Famer. And watching him turn it on, where some people would go there and they would just be such gunners and they'd be playing so crazy competitive and he would just steamroll them.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember this one guy came in with his like zombie deck that he'd put together. His kid, and, you know, Luis was doing everything he could to just punt that game away. And they get to a point where Luis has like just tons of creatures. The guy has nothing. And he's like, oh, can you just attack me with everything and kill me? And Luis's like, I guess I could do that. And he's like, oh, okay, I guess the game's over. So the guy, you know, shelves his deck. I was like, hey, do you want to play again? There's like a line of people. Yeah. And he's like, do you want to play again? And he plays again. And the guy gets his like zombie comp. And it was amazing. The guy was like, oh my God, I won. I can't believe I won. So like, those are the moments that are great. There was another one. We had Raptor gunslinging at one point, and there was a six-year-old kid he was playing with live. We were streaming this, and I wasn't there, and I saw it. It was so awesome where Raptor, obviously a master, future Hall of Famer. I mean, he is a Hall of Famer. He just hasn't been obviously a master, and sets it up perfectly with the kid where he attacks for non-lethal but doesn't have enough blockers up to survive the counter swing. And the kid's sitting there, and he goes, okay, I'm done, it's your turn. And the guy's like, kid draws his card, and he goes, okay. And he sees like two blockers when he's got like four or five creatures, and he's like, go ahead. And he goes, oh, do you want to attack? And he's like, do you have some blockers? He goes, I only have two. And like basically coaches the kid into swinging for lethal. He's like, oh my God, you killed me. Anyway, those are just great pre-release moments. So that's what pre-release is about.
Yeah, and actually, to kind of carry that pre-release idea forward, one of the cool things actually that they're doing for this set is there's the Grand Prix, I think it's the week after, is actually using Ixalan. It will actually be the release weekend of Ixalan. Mm-hmm. Is going to be a team-limited Grand Prix, which basically is as close to a pre-release Grand Prix as they'll ever have. So I'm going to go. I'm actually like going to have... I'm pretty excited. I'm going to play with Osip
Lebedowicz
and Ben Lundquist. So
old school team. Hashtag, we talked about this, right? Like, throwback team. It's like the 1999 All-Stars or something.
So that's going to be awesome. And so I think for me, Ixalan is going to be pretty exciting and fresh. And it's going to be interesting to split like four tribes amongst three people. Mm-hmm. So that's another thing that's kind of going to be a little crazy. So we're going to have a good time.
You got to call dibs. That's what
that's true.
Do. You know, and it's a lot of fun. I think, you know, the higher level players, and I'm excluding myself from this, though I do enjoy this, love that freshness, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like, the timing of this, it's the release weekend. You're not going to have a ton of experience with it. No one is. And you get to discover and play. And see, that's where the competitiveness becomes really fun, and it becomes different. So that's great. I will say, I think it was the Mirage Pro Tour. I want to say it was Mirage. Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso played at that Pro Tour, and they had to draft it. And it was on release weekend, and there were no spoilers. So you're drafting a set, opening the packs, and seeing the cards for the first time. Can you imagine doing that in a Pro Tour? You have no idea what the other cards in the set are.
I would love it.
And so like you're opening the pack and like, what's good in here? What are my impressions? And it's timed, and you're just trying to think. Can you imagine doing that at a Pro Tour? Never seen the cards before. Boom.
No, look. That'd be awesome.
That would be great.
And I'm hoping I have some of that feeling like when I play in Providence.
That's what we're trying to capture here. So, okay. we didn't get to any Ixalan previews. There's a list of stuff. Are there any cards you want to touch on here?
Look, I think the ones that I want to talk about is just the flip cards. I love the
that
mechanic in this set. I think they did really, really good job. I think the interesting ones that we haven't really had a chance to talk about yet are the legendary enchantments that actually turn into lands. I think like they're all like kind of like throwbacks to things that we know.
Well, one's
like,
one's a Gaia's Cradle.
Yeah, one is literal Gaia's Cradle.
Yeah, which is that the best one?
It might be the best constructed
it's
one.
Growing rights of how do you say it?
Itlamok.
I'm just going to call it Growing Rights. All right, let's just do that.
I think it's Itlamok, and I mean, it turns into a cradle, a literal cradle.
Actually just turns into Gaia's Cradle.
Right, and it's actually not very hard. You just need four creatures.
Easy to flip.
Yes.
It's one green, two other for legendary enchantment. When Growing Rights enters the battlefield, look at the top four cards of your library. You may reveal a creature card from among them and put it into your hand. Put the rest on the bottom of your library in any order at the beginning of your end step, okay? So at the end of the turn, you play it. If you already have three creatures and you drew a fourth, or you already have four creatures in play, if you control four or more creatures, flip it into Gaia's Cradle. It's just Gaia's Cradle.
It's actually slightly better than Gaia's Cradle, because if you have no creatures, it still taps for green.
Oh my gosh. You are oh my gosh, you're right. It is slightly so it's even better than Gradle. Unbelievable.
I mean, I think this card is going to be bonkers in limited. In modern. I think it's really, really good in modern.
Yeah. Well, limited is.
Yes, yeah. But I think it will probably be good enough in standard. I think all of these ones have a shot at being good enough in standard. I think there's some really, really good ones. I think the red one is really good. It kind of like does an impression of an Outpost Siege, if you remember that card. Mm-hmm. And it turns into. See.
So it's Vance's Blasting Cannon. Sorry. 1 red, 3 for a legendary enchantment. At the beginning of your upkeep, exile the top card of your library. If it's a non-land card, you may cast that card this turn. So it's almost like drawing it. Whenever you cast your third spell in a turn, you may transform Vance's Blasting Canyons. Okay. When you do flip it, it turns into Spitfire Bastion. Tap to add 1 red mana to your mana pool. 1 red, 2 Spitfire Bastion deals 3 damage to target creature or player. And that's colorless damage.
Yeah. No, that's... It's... Like, the flip side is insane. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a kind of flip that we hoped Shivan Gorge was back in the day.
True.
Right? It's like, this thing actually gets to, like, you know, hit creatures and players. This ends the game really quickly.
Yep.
I think the interesting part is it's... The front is really good. Like, it's actually, like, you actually want to keep it on its front side. The funny thing is, some of these enchantments, they force you to flip. Like growing rights, you actually have to flip,
mm-hmm.
but the red one you don't. And sometimes you actually just want to sit on it because it's kind of like a Howling Mine. Mm-hmm. It's not exactly like a Howling Mine. You can't play all the land, and you have to play that turn.
Mm-hmm.
But like in a long kind of grindy game, it's really good.
Right.
And it's funny. It's like some of them you have to, like the Legion's Landing. You have to flip.
One white for legendary enchantment. When Legion's Landing enters the battlefield, create a 1/1 white vampire creature token with lifelink. Doesn't fly. I hate non-flying vampires. I'm just going to say that.
They have lifelink. They're eating.
It's true. When you attack with 3 or more creatures, transform Legion's Landing. And then this is like Outpost, right?
Yeah. Yep. Okay.
It turns into Odonto the First Fort. Add 1 white to your mana pool. 1 white, 2. Tap, create a 1/1 white vampire creature token with lifelink. Gaia's Cradle still has some oomph.
This thing is really, like, it's 1 white.
Yeah, but it's just, like, it turns into an Outpost, dude.
No, but, okay, so the reason I like this one
okay.
is that your first one, you can play it, right? Second one, you can play it again, and you still get the 1/1 white.
Right, right, so now you have 2.
You have 2, and you can play a third one. So the actually drawing too many of these doesn't hurt, because they're basically, like, oaths.
I get that, but... Do we need an Outpost? Like, that's what you want?
I'm just saying it has some potential.
So you can flip it, that's great. But I'm just saying the brass ring ain't that great in my mind.
Look. Sure.
Okay. Search for Azcanta is the blue one. One blue, one other at the beginning for legendary enchantments. They're all legendary enchantments. At the beginning of your upkeep, look at the top card of your library. You may put it into your graveyard. Then if you have 7 or more cards in your graveyard, you may transform search for Azcanta. And when it flips, it turns into Azcanta, the Sunken Ruin. Add 1 blue mana to your mana pool. Tap to add 1 blue mana to your mana pool. 1 blue, 2 other, tap it. Look at the top 4 cards of your library. You may reveal a non-creature, non-land card from among them and put it into your hand. Put the rest on the bottom of your library in any order. It's Impulse.
This is probably the worst one, and it's not bad. It's just...
You think this is better than the white one?
I think the white
one... You think the white one's better than this?
I think the white one is better in more white decks, basically. Like, I actually think that the white one may be less powerful, but it will be... It fits into decks a little bit better than this blue one.
You can Impulse.
No, I mean, it's a good card.
It feeds itself the same way the white one does, right?
It does. I mean, I'm not saying this is a bad card.
It's not like I think it's close, and you're much better at Magic, and you're a game designer, so I feel stupid saying this. The blue one feels so much better.
I think the payoff... is better, but like I think if you like, part of it is you've got to want it in your deck, and I think the white one is more likely to be wanted in white weenie go white decks.
I mean, whereas that 1/1 life linking vampire.
I think a sorcery impulse is not that great. It's basically its front side is a sorcery impulse,
right?
Which doesn't actually fit into what you traditionally call a blue control deck.
But once you flip it, you're impulsing every turn.
I agree.
Every turn.
I think, funny enough, you know, I think the one the control decks want is the red one.
Yeah, the red one's the same. It's like a cursed scroll. I mean, it feels like cursed scroll, only it's guaranteed every time.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's guaranteed every time.
And it's 3 damage,
and
so.
And it's a howling mine, which yeah. is actually really, really yeah, yeah. cool.
Both sides of it are great. I mean, I think that card... I mean, I'm not disputing that. I think the blue one's much better than the white one. Yeah. All right, we've got...
One more.
We've got one last one, the black one. God, the names here. Who knew pirate names were so difficult? Do you know how many planes we've gone through? And this is the tough one. Argyle? Not Argyle. Argyle.
Yeah.
Argyle. That's what I got
it. It's like Miguel.
Miguel, Argyle. Oh, of course. It totally is.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm an idiot. Okay, pardon me, Argyle. Argyle's Bloodfast. One black, one other. For a legendary enchantment, one black, one other. Pay two life, draw a card. Now, it's not a tap thing, so you can do it as many times as you want. It's basically greed.
Yeah.
At the beginning of your upkeep, if you have 5 or less life, you may transform Argyle's Bloodfeast. What does it transform into? Temple of, oh my god. Aklazots.
Oh, not bad. I give you, yeah.
Okay.
B plus.
Temple of Aklazots. tap to add 1 black mana to your mana pool. Or tap, sacrifice a creature. You gain life equal to the sacrificed creature's toughness. High market. No, high market's only 1 life.
Huh? No, this is Diamond Valley.
Diamond Valley. That's where it is. Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's greed in Diamond Valley.
I actually think this card, like, when you look at it, it might be the worst one. But I have this feeling that this card is actually really good. I think this card's really good. What? No, like, greed is really...
Greed is good.
Yeah.
That's a throwback. I don't know how many people actually get that, but
I don't know.
Is good.
I mean, it's certainly the hardest one to put in the deck. It's not it doesn't naturally go
okay,
there.
Do you like the blue? Okay, black or blue here?
I think the blue one is better. I'll give you that.
Okay, so just rank them for me.
I think it goes... In standard or, like... In general, what do you like? Give me a context because I think it's different.
Okay, we'll go standard.
Standard one. Standard. Okay, standard. I think it goes red, green, white, blue, black. And I think in modern you definitely have to put the green one higher, and maybe you even have to put the white one higher than the red one in modern because I think 4 mana for this effect is not good enough. But I think maybe it might even be green, blue, white, red, black in modern. It's actually pretty different.
Well, because the mana cost becomes much, much huger in modern. In standard, I'm gonna say red, blue, green, white, black. I think that's how you gotta do it.
Okay.
I really think the blue one's great. I don't know if I'm on an island here or not. I think the blue one's... Let's take a moment here and talk about though. At least for the blood fast. I guess that's how you get there. But the feel of these cards, like.
Oh, it's
taking,
so good.
Taking over a land or finding land or finding that gateway to some mythical, you know, lost temple or whatever it is.
No, it's so really good story. So it's a Legion Landing. It's about like these conquistador vampires. They've hit there, they conquer, and then they turn into a fort.
Right.
Great. The blue one is like, they're looking for a lost temple,
area.
Right?
They find it.
So they find it. So they find temple. The Bloodfast, the reason why it's actually quite interesting, it's so the vampires, they're zealots. Mm-hmm. So what they're trying to do is a lot of them do kind of like they starve themselves to like attain like some sort
enlightenment.
Of enlightenment.
Sure.
And basically, once you've starved yourself enough, you've gotten down to 5 life, then you find enlightenment and this temple that allows you to gain back life.
Right. No,
so
it's really good. Yeah, yeah. By doing what? By killing creatures. Yeah.
Yeah.
So now that you've starved yourself, you can kill everything and gain a bunch of life. That's great.
No, you're sacrificing them. At the altar.
Temple, that's true, my bad. You're sacrificing. No. You can't kill them, but you can sacrifice
you can't
them.
You're sacrificing them. The blasting cannons is basically taking over a fort. It's basically they're shooting this place, and then it becomes a fort.
In true pirate fashion.
And I don't know really what the green one is.
Well, they're growing it. They're in a ritual where they're growing the tree.
Yeah.
The origin of it is they're growing the cradle.
Okay,
and so that's exactly what it is.
Look.
The flavor is
so good.
Unbelievable. It's great.
I love it.
So these cards, definite flavor win. Love it, love it, love it. I like the flip card aspect of it.
Yeah.
I think that's great. Going from enchantment to land is great. Okay. So that's what anything else you want to touch on with Ixalan?
I'm looking forward to it. I think the flavor's great. I actually think it looks like a really fun limited set. The proof is going to be the tasting. I'm going to kind
it's
of...
Always, it's always the proof
yeah.
is in the tasting.
Yeah.
Normally it's in the pudding, but the tasting, you have to taste the pudding.
In the eating. Proof is in the eating.
Proof is in the tasting. Proof is in the pudding. And I'm never sure if that's actual, like, milk pudding or, like, you know, the bread-style pudding. Like,
ooh, I love
Yorkshire
pudding.
I love... Bread not pudding. Bread pudding. Yorkshire pudding,
oh,
or, like,
yeah.
with roast beef.
Yeah.
Have you been to House of Prime Rib in the city?
Yeah, yeah.
God, I love that place. We should... That's where we should go.
Okay.
TBS and I have, like, this... We should get dinner sometime thing. Has never happened. We should definitely go to the HOPR. That place is amazing. All right, that is our Magic TV for the week. Two things, though. One, let's be real about how Pillage is totally omitted from Iconic Masters.
Okay,
let's just be real about it.
It's 25.
I don't want to hear this. It's 25 TBS, because guess what? You could print it in both. You could print it in both. What? Don't want to hear it.
Look, if they don't print it with the Richard Kane Ferguson, like, Balduvian barbarian art,
obviously,
it doesn't count. Like, they're going to use that silly 7th edition, like...
No, it's going to be new art. I bet you it's going to be all new art.
Richard Kane Ferguson is one of my favorite artists.
You know, his kids, it's funny. I met him, he was at Vegas, and his kids play Magic. And he was like, yeah, it was real tough. My kids wanted to come, but I was working, and, you know, I didn't want to spend a fortune to have them play. And I'm like, I love, obviously I love Pillage. I love RKF, like Arcane Denial, Dacon. I mean, you talk about Icon, Nebuchadnezzar, which probably no one even knows the art for, but Dacon, everybody knows the art for Dacon.
Nebuchadnezzar.
Nebuchadnezzar.
Oh my God!
Nebuchadnezzar.
This is a real person.
TBS. I'm sorry. Was he an Australian king?
Look,
because I don't think he was.
He's a Persian.
May be the Australian Persian pronunciation.
King. Nebuchadnezzar.
You're in the up over now. Okay, we do say things a little different here in the up over. Okay.
Down under for life.
Yeah. Arcane Denial. I mean, I can go on and on with this. His last art was probably in Shadowmoor. I think he had a piece of art, or Eventide or Shadowmoor. He had one of the enchantments, I think. But anyway, I told him, and I will reiterate this. I told RKF, I'm like, if you want to come to a GP, your kids can play for free. Just come play in the main event. I'll get him in for free because, he's a character, and he's got, last time, at Vegas, he had like Pillage artist proofs. I'm like, he has all these old artist proofs. I'm like, how do you have all these artist proofs for these cards? Unbelievable. Old school. So anyway, obviously a huge omission, and they could have printed it twice. We need more Pillage. I spent so long on that, I forgot my second point. Oh yeah, my second point was this. Please, I said this earlier in case you missed it, but it's genuine. If you feel strongly that the reserve list should still be in place, I honestly would love to hear, I don't want to attack anyone, I don't want to argue with anyone, but it's actually just a viewpoint that I just haven't had anyone come up to me and say, Mosh, I really think we should keep the reserve list. I think it's a good thing. And part of that's because I interact mainly with players, right? I don't interact with big-time collectors. I do interact with a lot of big-time collectors through Channel Fireball, but everyone I talk to these days is in favor of abolishing the reserve list. So just a little curiosity. Mashi gets curious. Curiosity is not a crime, as Dumbledore once said. So, okay, that is our Magic TV for the week, which means all we have left is this week's Top 8.